Hello and welcome to the episode 49 of What A Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today's highlights include several live performances, a meeting with a man with two names, and a momentous event on the London Stock Exchange. On the 18th of February 1961, the Beatles, with Pete Best on drums, performed for another BK Promotions night at the Aintree Institute in Liverpool. The band would have had a second engagement at the Casanova Club for the evening, but that dance night was moved to the 28th of February at the last minute. In 1962, the Beatles, still featuring Pete Best on drums, performed at the Casbah Coffee Club in Liverpool. Moving on to 1963, we find the Beatles performing twice at the Queen's Hall in Widnes. Both performances, an EMS production, were sold out well before the night. In 1964, still resting in Miami, the Beatles met Cassius Clay, later known as Muhammad Ali, at the 5th Street Gym. The boxer was preparing for his 25th of February fight with Sonny Liston for the heavyweight championship. The meeting was a huge publicity event, with many journalists present and a number of funny pictures being taken. Later in the day, the lads went to a drive-in movie, where they watched Elvis's Fun in Acapulco. And now, before going on, I would like to give you a little reminder. If you like this podcast, please visit www.simonmas.com/support to see how you can help me increasing the quality of these shows. You can really make the difference in a number of ways: bringing the podcast to the attention of your friends, making a small donation to buy me a coffee, or leaving me a comment so that I won't feel too lonely. Okay, let's move on. We get quite a big day for the 18th of February 1965. Let's start with the music. The day began at 10 a.m. in the control room of Studio 2, with a mixing session attended by all the four Beatles, focusing on Ticket to Ride, Another Girl, I Need You, and Yes It Is. Everyone took a break at 1 p.m. for lunch and returned to work at 3:30 p.m. The band completed John's new song, You Got to Hide Your Love Away, in 9 takes. The song marked the first instance in which an external musician, other than producer George Martin, was called in to reinforce the sound of the Beatles. The honor went to Johnny Scott, who played tenor and alto flute on the song in exchange for a £6 fee, about £120 in 2020 money. As customary at the time, he did not receive any credit on the album's sleeve. Truth to be told, Andy White did play drums on the first version of Love Me Do on the 11th of September 1962, and so he should be the one honored here, but in that instance, White did not complement the band's sound as much as he substituted Ringo's. Anyhow, between 5:15 and 6 p.m, another mono mixdown session completed the work on the night before And You Like Me Too Much. After 30 minutes of rest, the band kicked in yet another session, the third of the day, taking place from 6:30 to 10:30 p.m. They completed a number called If You Got Trouble, featuring Ringo on vocals. The song was ready after 1 take and the relative overdubs, but it was soon dismissed as not to par with the material the band was working on, and only surfaced with the release of Anthology 2. Later, the Beatles also completed Tell Me What You See in 4 takes and overdubs. The track was not selected to be included in the upcoming second Beatles film soundtrack, and ended up in the non-film pile of material for their next album. While all this work was going on, an important business development was underway. The Beatles' song publishing company, Northern Songs, went public on the London Stock Exchange. The company, previously owned by John Lennon, Paul McCartney, manager Brian Epstein, Dick James, and Charles Silvers, was reorganized into 1,250,000 shares. John and Paul retained 15% of the shares each. Brian Epstein's NEMS acquired a 7.5%, James and Silvers got 37.5%, and George and Ringo together received 1.5%. The remaining 23.4% of the stock was sold on the market with an initial price of 7 shillings 9 pence, about £6.80 in 2020 money, and the obligation to purchase a minimum of 200 shares for the hefty sum of £39, about £690 in 2020 money, that put them out of reach of most of the fans of the band. Initially ignored by various financial institutions, the stock quickly rose in price to appreciate by 288% by the end of the day. This made everyone richer, of course. As a consequence, for example, John and Paul each made £94,270, about £1,661,000 in 2020 money. The best was that it was all tax-free. This was one of the main reasons that caused James to push for the public offering of the company, a way to reduce the tax burden for John and Paul, who, following their successes in 1963 and 1964, were paying an overall tax rate of 83% on their publishing earnings. There's no reason to doubt that Lennon and McCartney were anything but overjoyed by the whole affair, but they ignored a simple caveat. This move made Northern songs vulnerable to takeover attempts. This would turn out to be one of the crucial points in the breakup of the Beatles. Finally, in 1970, Ringo Starr had a double session at the EMI Studios. Between 2:30 and 6 p.m., Ringo re-recorded his vocals for Have I Told You Lately That I Love You and Let the Rest of the World Go By, two titles for his Sentimental Journey LP. Then, starting from 7 p.m., he took part in the recording of the basic rhythm track for his You Gotta Pay Your Dues, later renamed It Don't Come Easy. With George Martin producing and George Harrison directing the musicians on the studio floor, the band, including Ringo on drums, George on acoustic guitar, Steven Stills on piano, and Klaus Voormann on bass, recorded 20 takes of the track. Then, George overdubbed two electric guitar tracks while Ringo overdubbed his vocals. The session was concluded by 4:30 a.m. with a stereo mixdown of the song. This concludes another episode of What A Fab Day. See you tomorrow for another show. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.